Hello everyone and welcome back to Age of Nagash, which is a channel dedicated to Age of Sigmar. And in this video, we are going to be continuing my long in-depth Ossiarch Bonereapers series in part 3. So already we've looked in part 1 about the allegiance abilities for the Ossiarch Bonereapers, and then in part 2 we looked at the sub-allegiances, so the Ossiarch Bonereaper legions. And in this video, it's going to be the first one actually looking at models and units within the Ossiarch Bonereapers, and in particular, their standard units, as I'll call it. So this will be things like the Mortek Guard, be the Kavalos Deathriders, it will be the Imortis Guard, it will be the Necropolis Stalkers, be the Morghast Archi, and the Morghast Harbingers. So those sort of four core for the army, it's a little bit different because I'd like to call them, you know, your basic units. Neither of them are basics. None of them are basic. They are all very elite in terms of when it comes to Age of Sigmar. However, for this army, they're your standard units before you go into things like your behemoths and your heroes. So we'll be looking at units in this video, and in the next video, we'll be looking at heroes and so on. And when we're looking at the units in this video, I will be mentioning good synergies they have, but when it comes to talking about them in certain battalions, we are going to be doing a battalion video later down the road in this series, so you're just going to have to wait for that one now. And also, if there's anything you would like to add to this conversation, make sure you put it down in the comments down below so I can see that, and everyone else who is interested in learning Ossiarch Bonereapers can see that as well. So you could be watching this video brand new to Ossiarch Bonereapers, I'd suggest you to go watch my How to Start Collecting Them and also my Why Play video for Ossiarch Bonereapers. And what I will say as well is if you've been a little bit experienced with Ossiarch Bonereapers and you're watching this and maybe you go, I want a reason to not just have to take Mortek Guard, because Mortek Guard seem to be so good and really make it hard for me to justify taking the other units in this army. Hopefully in this video, I'll be able to help you with that dilemma, as it's something I've came across as well. So before we get fully into it, I do of course want to do a massive shout out to my patrons and YouTube members. Because of these beautiful people, I can continue to make videos for you guys on YouTube and continue to keep up the content to try and help people get into Age of Sigmar and continue their Age of Sigmar journey. So my biggest supporters are going to be my Morghasts. That's going to be Johnathan H, Filq, Bleed Red, and Christopher G. Thank you so much for your continued support, guys, especially at that level as well. It's making a huge difference. And then my vampires, which are Mir, Martinez, Rouse321, David A, Ronni H, Doug P, SpareBear, Christopher H, and Northdrop. Thank you as well, guys, so much for supporting the channel. At that tier, it's making a big difference as well. And then my Necromancers, which is going to be Jacq.l, RadiationRiley, AW77, Die Sagas, WolfNick, Michal W, Quad, Cranky Wombat, Christopher, Christopher C, James S, Steve T, Robin S, and James T. Thank you so much for your continued support as well, guys. It's all making a big difference. If anyone would like to support the channel in that way, make sure you click the join button next to the subscribe button, or there's a link to my Patreon on the top of the description down below. So if you would like to check that out, absolutely fine, but we can get more into that later, because we're going to start off by talking about the Mortek Guard, as they are really the main bulk of the Ossiarch Bonereapers. And as you guys know, that I do also like to talk about the lore, so we're going to read a little bit of segment of the lore for each one of these units before we go into its war scroll. So, the core of the Ossiarch Empire, the Mortek Guard are superior, yet numerous battle constructs that wage war with unnatural skill. They fight with the vigour of the living, yet without the doubt and fear and confusion that can plague a normal army when the fog of war descends and the din of battle rages around them. Each Mortek Guard is a walking mass grave, a soldier made from the dense bone that is the Ossiarch Tithe. They are given animus by the fractured remnants of a dozen of warrior souls, a miragerie of warlike personalities that fight as an exceptional, efficient whole. In battle, they can fight as individuals acting on their own instincts or act in strong formation if their Hecatos leader demands it. Blades striking out with lethal precision to open throat and pierce hearts. At a stern order from their commander, the Mortek line turns and reforms in an instant. Facing their enemy with a wall of razor-sharp edged Nagarite weapons. So that is a bit about the lore for the Mortek Guard there. And believe me, in-game, when they usually buff up a lot when they talk about the lore for units, they go, oh, they're amazing, this and all that, and you read the rules and go, absolute bollocks, they're not. The Mortek Guard pretty much do live up to their lore. So, they are going to be battle lining your army. So, they are one of the only two battle lines your army actually possesses, which is Cavalos Deathriders, which we'll get to next, and then the Mortek Guard. They're going to come in min-sized units of 10, max-sized units of 40, and their points currently of recording, which is the 5th of the 4th of 2021, you know, time-stamped, is going to be 130 points for 10, but 440 for 40 of them, which actually means you save 80 points if you take a mass block of 40. We'll get to in a moment if that's a good idea or a bad idea. And what I will say as well, just a little note, they are the cheapest battle line in your army. Like I said, they are one of two battle line, and the Cavalos Deathriders are 180 points for 5. So these are the cheapest battle line. In case in this army you just want to have a quick, you know, cheap battle line there, it's still going to cost you 390 points for the cheapest battle line requirements in a 2,000 point army, because you would need 3 10-man units of Mortek Guard to do it the cheapest. And now having a look at their war scroll, what are we going to get with them? So looking at their description first, a unit of Mortek Guard has any number of models. The unit is armed with one of the following weapon options: the Nagarite blade and shield, or Nagarite spear and shield. One in every 10 models can replace their unit's weapon option with a Soul Cleaver Greatblade, which sounds fantastic, but we'll get into a moment why you don't replace it with that unless you just want diversity in how your models look. So, looking at the will stats, we have a 4-inch move, a 4+ save, a bravery 10, and 1 wound. So bear in mind, these are like, you know, the new tougher skeletons. It's not too bad there. A better save than Grave Guard, and although a lot more expensive. And when you look at things like a 4-inch movement, remember, you have that command ability in your army that this unit can do independently if it's in range of its Hecatos or in range of a hero as well. They can make themselves move an extra 3. So it may look like 4-inch move, but a lot of the time, if you need them to move the extra distance, they are moving 7. And then you can take them in the Static Lord sub-allegiance, which we mentioned in the last video, which means that you can make this unit run in charge. And you can't make this unit run an automatic 6, as you don't have access to those main general's handbook command abilities. But what you can do is say the low average you're going to get on a run is a 3, right? Because it's just 1d6, it's either going to be a 3 or 4 on the average, and just say the lower average is a 3. But because of your banner, which we'll get to in a moment, you get +1 to your run rolls and your charge rolls. So actually, this unit on average, if you want it to run, will go 11 inches. And then if it's in Stalag Lords, that means that you can still charge. So when you look at 4 inches on its movement, don't think that's literally how far and only how far that unit is going to move. And it's also important to note that if you're an opponent of Ossiarch Bonereapers, that when you, let's say you're not really familiar with the army, but you're going to go against this here, just have a quick scan of the war scrolls, they can move a hell of a lot faster than that. But then going on to the meta weapons, so we've got the Nagarite Blade. So this is a 1-inch range, 2 attacks, freeze to hit, force to wound, -1 rend, 1 damage. That is nice there. You'll see in the Ossiarch Bonereapers that a lot of the units do suffer from the force to wound, which can really hurt this army. I mean, there are ways to make it go down to 2s to hit, and like you can even re-roll 1s as well. You can do that without too much drama, and then you basically roll your hits, you fail like 2 out of, I don't know, let's just say 40 dice, and then you roll to wound, and then suddenly, before you know it, only 10 were successful. And you just have to bear with that. It's something that you've got to play around. There are ways to help out your wounding, depending on how you want to go. But then we go on to the Nagarite Spear, which is a 2-inch range, 2 attacks, freeze to hit, force to wound, no rend and 1 damage. So the big question is, do we go blade or do we go spear? Now we go blade, and I'll tell you the reason for this. It's because I know they only have 1-inch range, and you might go, well, I want to take a block of 40 of them, and then it's going to be hard for them all to get in range. However, these guys, in case you aren't completely familiar, they're on 25mm bases, right? Which, when you rank them up to attack the enemy, and you pile in and try and get as close to those enemy bases as possible to get as many models in, because their bases are 25mm, an inch of the range of their Nagarite blade is just a bit bigger than 25mm, which then means 2 ranks of Mortek Guard can attack the enemy if they're base to base with your front rank, and your front rank is basically base to base with those enemy models. You can get 2 ranks in. Now, you may be going, well, if I've got a block of 40, it may be harder to get every single one in because, you know, I might have to have more than two ranks. I get you, but trust me, that minus one rend, particularly in the game at the moment, is worth the sacrifice. If these guys were on 32mm bases, so you can natch your 1-inch range weapons, get two ranks in, I would say go spears. But because they are on, like I say, those bases, definitely go blades. And then when we go on to the Soul Cleaver Great Blade, it's a 1-inch range, two attacks, freeze the hit, freeze the wound, minus one rend, one damage. So you may have heard me earlier go, well, why would I not take this? It's just wounded on freeze. You just said how hard it is to try and wound well in this army. I get you. However, we'll go to that in a moment in an ability. And then going into the abilities and the rest of the description, it says a Necropolis, I believe that's how it's pronounced, may be wrong with that one. So one in every 10 models in this unit can be a Necrophorus. Actually, I think that's how it's pronounced. Add one to the running charge rolls of this unit if it includes any Necrophorus. So, or Fori, if it's singular, I think maybe. Anyway, basically, the banner. And this is what I was mentioning earlier, when you get that plus one to your run and charge rolls. Generally really, really good. Because you don't have access to your generic command ability to reroll charge rolls from the General's Handbook, what that means is you can fail 3-inch charges. And when I say you can fail 3-inch charges, maybe, yeah, what are the odds? When I was learning Ossiarch Bonereapers in my first few games and stuff, and it's happened since then as well, I've had a unit of 10 Deathriders, the Kavalos Deathriders, the cavalry, and what happens is they get 3 inches away from the enemy, you know, because they can't get any closer because they'd be in combat otherwise, and then they rolled a charge, and they rolled a double one twice in a game for their two charges in that game. So that plus one to charge really is important. It doesn't matter how fast you can shoot up the field if you can still fail a 3-inch charge. So yeah, that is really important. And also it's going to help you with your longer range charges. Just bear in mind you can't charge 13 inches because it doesn't state that. You can still only charge an enemy if you're within 12 inches of them. You still have to play within the rules of the game. You know, you're not Lumineth Realm Lords. Apart from when it comes to command points, you tweak things, obviously. But, so the Mortek Hecatus. So one model in this unit can be a Mortek Hecatus. And one to the attack characteristics of that unit's melee weapon. So it's just the leader gets plus one attack, sounds standard and normal. Very important though, because that Mortek Hecatus is the leader. And when he is the leader, it actually means something in this army in terms of he leads from the front. He leads, well, I say the front, more from the center of the unit. Because if your whole unit is going to be within... wholly within 6 inches of him, they're going to get their death save because then you don't need to be in range of a hero. So when you stretch really thin with this unit, even if you've got a unit of 10 of them and you stretch them quite thin, you have to be careful that you don't, when I mean thin, I mean just stretch them one line. You have to be careful that you don't make yourself outside of range of that 6 inches, because I've done it before. I've done it with a unit of 20. I've done it with Kavalos Deathriders as well, because they have the same thing, the Mortek Hectors. You want to make sure that you're within or wholly within every model is of the Mortek Hecatus. Obviously, some situations may be worth the sacrifice, not to be, but it's something to definitely try and remember. It's all about those ranges to keep on track on. And then going on to the main ability, so the Nagarite Weapons. And this is one of a very good ability they have, and it is if the unmodified hit roll for an attack made with this unit's Nagarite Blade or Nagarite Spear is a 6, that attack it scores 2 hits on the target instead of 1. Make a wound roll and save roll for each hit. So exploding 6s. When you get a 6 to hit, you roll 2 wound dice. Which is very nice, especially how, like I said, you can be hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s with this. You can try and get as many 6s as you can possible to try and generate all those extra attacks. Something I'll just say is, like, when I played this army, I've noticed that I don't quite often get any 6s to hit. And I know that's just, like, a bit of luck or something, but what I'd say is don't aim for it. Don't go, they're going to go in there, they're going to fight, and they're going to get loads of 6s to hit, and it's going to get me enough attacks to make the enemy have to make enough wounds to just about kill them. If you, for example, you look at an enemy unit and it's got 24 wounds left on it, and you've got a unit of 10 of these guys, and you go, that's 21 attacks, but I'm going to generate some more hits by getting those 6s to hit, and then that'll get me enough wounds to be able to kill that unit. Don't overthink it too much like that, you won't get it. But the reason why it's important to mention the Nagarite weapons as well is because, going back to the Soul Cleaver Great Blade, like I said I would, that is not a Nagarite weapon, so it does not have the exploding 6s. Now, I get it. That I just said that, well, it's not that easy to get those 6s anyway, so why would I sacrifice the plus one to wound with that weapon? a couple of things, really, because you don't get those exploding sixes, so I think the Nagarite Blade is better to get a chance of getting those exploding sixes. And also, saves you having to roll a different colour die, so it saves you having to roll those attacks after. However, what I will mention is I've modelled my Mortek Guard as I'm building them. I have modelled them with the Soul Cleaver Greatblade, but I'll just say to my opponent, yes, I'm sure they will be fine with it if I can just use it as a Nagarite Blade. It is weird for the special weapon to be, at worst, not as good as the normal weapon, and at best, as good as the normal weapon. I think it's a little bit weird. If it had that extra like rend, and maybe it was minus 2 rend, that'd be cool, but it doesn't. So that's why I say just say it's got a Nagarite Greatblade, and your opponent would be happy for you to not roll as many dice as well. So then going on to the command abilities, which we have Shield War, and this is what the Mortek Guard are very formidable and very well known for, I would say, because you can use this command ability at the start of the combat phase. If you do so, pick one friendly Mortek Guard unit that includes a Mortek Hecatus, like I've already mentioned, very important. You can reroll save rolls for attacks that target this unit until the end of that combat phase. So this is also why you want to have that Mortek Hecatus in this unit more than anything else, because this command ability, Shield Wall, is fantastic. It makes this unit survive so much longer. It makes them kind of like on the map of Age of Sigmar being how defensive they can be, because they can just bounce so many attacks back. It was known when Petra Elite first came out that gave the Mortek Guard as a flat plus one save that a free up reroll in for your basic battle line is pretty goddamn strong. Also, if you take the Mortis Praetorians, Catacross, so a bit of a points investment, but you can make your Mortek Guard as well as everything else in the army that's in range of him, plus one to save as well. So you could have your Mortek Guard in your Mortis Praetorians led by Catacross having that free up save reroll in, which is huge. So I will say though, Mortek Guard from experience, they will melt to mortal wounds unless you have like empowered Nagarite Shields or whatever it's called. It's a spell on that gives them like a 5-up mortal wound save. There's ways to try and help them in the book, but generally they will melt to mortal wounds. However, they will do pretty well against your standard enemy attacks and even your standard enemy attacks with a bit of rend because of that rerolling. It is huge. Something to note now though, in Petrified Elite, where you no longer get that plus one save because it was, in all honesty, broken, you get to reroll ones to save in combat. So it kind of makes this command ability feel not as good, or it makes that reroll save rolls a one ability not as good because you may make it redundant by just spending a command point here. But if you don't have, not a command point, so those relentless discipline points, those reroll ones to save can definitely help. But I just thought it's nice to mention that you can still have that free up save of rerolling, making these guys incredibly hard to kill unless you have a lot of mortal wound potential. And then talking about the keywords, so we've got Death, Ossiarch Bonereapers, Mortek Guard, very few keywords there, but it's absolutely fine to be honest with you. It's all you need. So to talk about the Mortek Guard, when you first look at them when you go into Ossiarch Bonereapers, or how I did anyway, is I looked at them and I went, right, okay, this is my defensive unit, okay? This is my anvil. And then I have to start looking at other things to be my hammer. You know, so this is my defensive unit and then I had to look at other things to be my aggressive unit, basically. And then after a few games of taking units of like 40 Mortek Guard, I realised that the Mortek Guard are actually the hammer as well as being the anvil. And then I kind of looked at everything else in the army that was like a unit, if you will, like everything else I'm going to look in this video. And I was like, ah, they kind of do, like pound for pound, a better job than the rest of you lot when it comes to being offensive and defensive. So then it kind of got to the point where it's like, should I only take Mortek Guard for my units? Or maybe a unit of Kavalos Deathriders or something as well. So that's when it dawned on me. Because even like a unit of 20 of these guys is pretty good. Because if you take a unit of 20 of these guys, or two units of 20 of these guys, and a Harvester as well, which is the big corpse cart walking thing with the short legs and the literal guy as a boner, that can really make these guys much more survivable and just a pain for your enemy to deal with if you have one of those harvesters in your army. And then you kind of question if you need the Necropolis Stalkers or the Immortal Guard or the Morghasts and everything else, which is a conversation we'll have in this video. But the Mortek Guard are a very easy unit to be able to do a lot of things. You may go there incredibly slow, but with the relentless discipline points spent on them, they can move very fast, like I've already mentioned, especially depending on what sub-legions you want to take them in. But it's just something I do want to say, rather than just go, these guys are just defensive and that's it, they can be better than the rest of your units in combat. However, I have been trying out the other units when I've been playing games recently to try and get as much experience as possible for doing this series, and I'm happy to say that I have found use with some of the other units and not just Mortek Guard. For example, a list that I've been playing a lot lately, and I took it to a tournament and I went 2-1, so I won two games and then I lost my last game. And the last game was, it was fairly close and like unlucky priorities and stuff, but played against a great guy who killed me with 21 Yetis, so that was quite funny, in Winterbite. They did really well, that list, and how I played it, and it didn't have a single Mortek Guard. So it shows that it's not purely down to Mortek Guard, and that's why I wanted to do that and take it to a tournament to try and prove to you guys who are doing this video series and to myself that you can look beyond Mortek Guard and you don't have to stop looking when you read their war scroll and you play them a few games. If you think some of the other units are cool, you can try and make them work. And now that we've probably been talking about Mortek Guard now for, I don't know, nearly 20 minutes, I think we'll move on to the Kavalos Deathriders. And again, starting with their lore, the foremost cavalry of Nagash's new order, the Kavaloi, are famed across Shaiish for their tireless assault and expert riding skills on the field of battle. A regiment of such riders can flank an enemy army, driving a wedge of their attack deep into the heart of the foe before withdrawing to charge again. Far ahead, the heat haze on the horizon shimmers and resolves into what appears to be cavalry, riding hard. Banners snap in the desert dry winds. One sunlight glints on ornate helms and heavy shields. The sounds of Nagarite shod hooves haunt the cusp of hearing, a rolling thunder that is soon to break. Only as they grow steadily close does the true import of the situation become clear. These are no normal riders, but undead horrors of twisted bone. These are the short cavalry of Nagashazar, sent to run down the foes of the Ossiarch Empire. Their duty to destroy, hack, and trample until there is nothing left of the enemy but dismembered corpses. So that's a little bit about them in the lore. Very cool. A little things as well that I've already mentioned in other videos is that when you look at the horse itself, it could be made bone from things like Maw Crushers or like a Carnosaur and all those sorts of things. And that's why a lot of the heads are a bit different to reflect that. Or bones from demons and everything. It makes it all quite interesting. Something else as well is that the souls that empower the horses are also can be souls from great beasts, but also can be souls from people who annoyed Nagash and wants them to spend the rest of eternity trapped within the encagement of a beast. And now that we know what they're like in the lore, what are they like in the game? Well, you can get Kavalos Deathriders for a minimum unit of 5 or a maximum unit of 15. They're 180 points for 5 or 480 points for 15. So you do get a regiment discount there of 60 points, if my math does me right. So that's not too bad. Nice to see a regiment discount. Especially as, like I said, the army is very highly point costed. Not saying it's too highly point costed overall, but it's just a rarely army, so the point costs are going to be quite high. So then going on to their war scroll. So the description, a unit of Kavalos Deathriders can have any number of models. Again, that's only for a narrative and open play. If you play a match play, abide by the rules I just said. The unit is armed with one of the following weapon options, a Nagarite blade and shield or a Nagarite spear and shield. So we then go on to the wheel stat, which is a 12-inch move. Again, that can be made to a 15-inch move pretty easily with that standard Relentless Discipline command ability. They can have for being Ossiarch Bonereapers. It then has a 4-plus save, which, like I said, can be made to a 3-plus save if taken in Immortal Tutorials with Catacross. But, you know, we can't look at everything just if it's with Catacross. I to be honest, haven't had loads of experience with Cash Cross yet, because I know that's what a lot of people go for, so I like to try and try things differently, and I've taken a lot of Kavalos Deathriders, and like a 4+ save with like rerolling ones from combat from Petra Elite can be quite nice as well. And then we've got Bravery 10 and 3 Wounds. The 3 Wounds is particularly nice because they are smaller looking cavalry. Now, they're not as small as like a normal bloke riding a horse, but they are smaller than things like Chaos Knights and other larger creatures such as that. It's nice to see them on a smaller scale still getting that 3 Wounds there. So they are very tough. And then going into their weapons, we'll see a similar trait here to the Mortek Guard because they are essentially just Mortek Guard riding the horses. The horses are called the Kavalos at the end of the day. And then the meta weapons, like we say, I've got the Nagarite Blade, so 1-inch range, 3 attacks, 3 stir, force to wound, martial rend, 1 damage, so pretty much like the Mortek Guard. However, they get an extra attack, which is nice. And then we've got the Nagarite Spear, which is the 2-inch range, 3 attacks, 3 stir hit, force to wound, no rend and 1 damage. So again, we've got an extra range there. Well, they're lacking the rend. However, there is like an other benefit of having the Nagarite Spear we'll get to in a moment before we decide which one is better. And then going on to the rest of the description, it says that this unit's Kavalos Steeds attacks with its hooves and teeth and it's a mount. So in case there's anything that affects them that wouldn't affect a mount, it won't help out the Kavaloses basically. And then going on to the Banner Bearer as well. So 1 in 5 models can be a Banner Bearer. Add 1 to the run and charge rolls for this unit and includes the Banner Bearer, which is very nice, like I've already mentioned for the Mortek Guard. Same reasons there. And like I said, I got a 2-inch charge twice in a game not so long ago with the Death Riders. And well, first time they had the Standard Bearer. Second time they didn't have the Standard Bearer. So they couldn't charge, which was really annoying. So make sure you keep the Standard Bearer alive. How it goes is you want to make sure the Mortek Hectorus is the last one to die, but then after that, Standard Bearer, of course. And then we've got a Mortek Hectorus, which again, he gets add 1 to his melee attacks for his blade or spear, basically, not for the horse, which is nice though, because when you look at it and you go, oh, I've only just got like 1 left, right? Just a Hectorus less than a unit, and he's going to attack. And you suddenly go, there's 4 attacks with that blade. Which, if we go on to the next ability, which is the Nagarite Weapons ability, it's the same as the Mortek Guard, pretty much, in terms of 6s to hit, score additional hits going into wounds, so like we said, those exploding 6s. But the nice thing, though, is Nagarite Spears that score 2 hits on the target instead of 1. However, when they make a charge move, essentially, when they've done a charge, you know, charging there with their spears, what is their charge bonus? Well, instead of the 6s generating those hits to explode, it's going to be 5s that explode those hits. So you can see a trade-off with the spears. They get the extra range and they also get this. What are my thoughts with it? So I've ran units of 5 and 10. I haven't got loads of experience with running units of 15 yet, but I do want to. I've got a list planned for that. But when I do run units of 5 and 10, units of 5 definitely go blades. It's just it's too small of a unit to justify saying the extra range and the bonus on the charge. So definitely go blades. And then when it comes to things like units of 10, now there may be some disagreement here, but I definitely say go blades. Because blades have that reliability with that rend. Because although the extra attacks and everything are good, however, at that point, you might as well just be attacking with a horde of zombies. Like, it's just buckets of attacks, hoping they go through. And I know, like, a weight of dice, you know, makes the opponent fail. Well, sometimes it doesn't. So sometimes you need that rend. So that's why I say Nagarite Blade. And honestly, with a unit of 10, most of the time, I didn't have a problem with getting them all to fight. And if I did, it wasn't because, oh, their piling didn't get them that far, because we'll get them in the command bit at the moment and see how good their piling can be. But it was more like because I wanted to keep them in range of like a Liege Kavios at the like in the combat phase, so they would be able to get that extra attack, something like that, and other abilities that are out there, such as just the standard 6-up death save from your Mortek Hectorus in this unit. And what I will say is, when I had to sort of like condense myself a little bit and group up a little bit more, so I wasn't out of range of things like my 6-up death save from like the Mortek Hectorus, exactly everything else. The extra inch on the range of the weapons wouldn't have made a difference. And because you want to attack with your hooves and teeth of your steeds, because it wounds on a 3, which is pretty cool, wounds better than a blade for somehow, but you want to be within 1 inch. And anyway, so it just makes sense for going with the Nagarite Blade, in my honest opinion. But a unit of 15, I'd be interested to try out to see if the spears be better, but because your piling can be so good, which we'll get to now as we keep talking about it, I wouldn't worry too much about the extra range. You just might miss out on a couple not attacking, which I think is a sacrifice fair enough to make you not have to miss out on the better attacks you're getting from the Nagarite Blade. So anyway, the command ability. So the Deathrider's Wedge. So you can use this command ability when a friendly Kavalos Deathrider unit that includes a Mortek Hectors finishes a charge move. You can pick one enemy unit within a 1 inch of that Kavalos Deathrider unit and roll a number of dice equal to the number of models in that Kavalos Deathrider unit. For each 5+, the enemy unit suffers one mortal wound. In addition, in the following combat phase, that Kavalos Deathrider unit can move an extra 3 inches when it piles in, which is really big, and that's why I say like the lack of the extra 1 inch range you get with the spear doesn't really like affect you too much, because you get that massive pile in. You usually have a lot of discipline points. So for me, for example, where my list I was running 3 units of Kavalos Deathriders, 1 unit of 10 and 2 units of 5. Oftenly I had enough relentless discipline points to at least do it of one of them, always the unit of 10, and sometimes a unit of 5 or something, just to get some mortal wounds through. I'll be honest with those mortal wounds, sometimes you'll roll, and like even if you've got like a unit of 5 of them, you think like at least one of these will be a mortal wound to the enemy, and then you don't get any 5s. But then sometimes you roll 5 dice and you get like 3 5 pluses, like 2 5s and 1 6, and suddenly that's an extra 3 mortal wounds. Or of a unit of 10, you got a nice big surprise and did like 7 mortal wounds. Not always guaranteed to happen, but when it does, can really help to make sure that these guys punch through. Now, I'm someone who usually plays a lot with things like Chaos Knights, with like Cursed Lances, or Glaives, or whatever they're called. And what that means is that I'm used to having cavalry that, when it hits the enemy, needs to break the enemy, because it's not going to be good if it's bogged down in combat. The Kavalos Deathriders, nice thing about them, is yeah, they get this bonus on the charge, but if you've gone for the blades, there's not really too much difference with them charging or not. And I say to my opponent quite a lot at the start of the game, they haven't really gone against Death Riders. They'll go, they'll ask me, like, do I want to make sure that the Kavalos Death Riders don't charge? As my opponent goes, do they want to stop my Kavalos Death Riders charging? And I say to them, like, well, I explain the bonus they get at the command ability and everything else, because I've got the blades, I'm like, they're not too bad even when they get charged anyway. So they're like a really nice versatile unit, and that's why I like them. The biggest problem they have is similar to the Mortek Guard in the terms of their wounding on fours, which really hurts them. To be honest, the hooves and teeth from the mount isn't too bad. A lot of the time you're hitting on a plus one anyway, because you're in range of a Bone Type Shrieker or another ability, and that's not really too much of a problem. So like the hooves and teeth, actually, their attacks go through quite nicely to making the enemy do saves. But the wounding on fours really does hurt. Like I said, I could roll a bucket load of hits, score loads of them, and then just like literally have like a fifth or a sixth of the hits I managed to score go through to wounded. So wounded on fours, you'll find, does hurt this army, but there's not loads you can do to it. There's like a, like we looked in a previous video, there's like an artifact you can give a Soul Mason to give them plus one to wound, or you can go more to Praetorians and get a Xantos to help them get like rerolls to wound and stuff. So there's ways to do it, but there's no like real easy way apart from the Xantos way, but it forces you to go in a sub-allegiance with that. Now, the other thing I like about Kavalos Deathriders, and the reason why I took them over Mortek Guard, which I think is important for me to mention as well from my experience, is Mortek Guard, like I said, everyone goes on about them, they're amazing, it's like the main unit you need in your army, and there's also catapults, which is a discussion for another video. But the Kavalos Deathriders, what I loved about them is that I could use them to screen the front of my army, or if the enemy doesn't really have any much like thing that's just going to run up and hit me, like an alpha strike or something like that, I could use them to screen the back of my army if the enemy's going to like deep strike things on, as an example, and try and like outflank me and stuff. And the Death Riders can just stay at the back, holding objectives. And then when I've dealt with any enemy deep strike and all that's gone and everything else, then the Death Riders in 2 turns can cross the battlefield and get in a fight or take an objective. They have so much speed that you can, even if you don't run them, if you've got the discipline points, which if you're careful, you will do your best to make sure you do, they're moving 15 a turn. Run them as well, average 4, moving 19 a turn. So you can get them to move at 19, and then on like turn 5, then they move 15 and can still charge. So, you know, that's absolutely huge range. And they're really good for late game, and the speed is great. Because like I said, the Mortek Guard are faster than they look, but they're nowhere near as fast as these guys. These guys, You know, they're not Eidner Deepkin eels, but because they can't fly and everything else, but they're for like, you know, on the ground cavalry. Don't want to call them traditional cavalry because they're not really traditional. They're a lot cooler than that. They are really fast. If they could fly as well, that'd be great, but you know, it's fair enough. I don't blame them that they can't. So that's why I really like the Death Riders for their versatility and their really good late game play. They're pretty hard to kill. They're very tanky, so when you use them as a screen at the front, like I use them to screen my 10 Kavalos Death Riders I had, and then also I had a unit of 6 Necropolis Stalkers, so I'd have a unit of 5 Kavalos Death Riders to screen each one. And they did that job really well. They would generally take the impact of an enemy charge, and even if the enemy did kill them, then in my turn I would just counter charge. And the other thing I like about the Kavalos Death Riders, like I said, they could sit at the back of the board and screen against the enemy, but also they can sit on your back objectives, and then when the enemy has no more teleporting or any more threats or flanking to try and get your back objectives in late game, then these Kavalos Death Riders that are on full, you know, 5 models in a unit can then charge forward and get to those objectives the enemy still has left to try and get you that extra VP to help you win your game, to get that major victory. So Kavalos Death Riders, I'm a big fan of them. I would say don't get too tied up and go, and they're going to do loads of damage on the charge. I've charged like a unit of 10 of them in, and sometimes they just fluff the rolls, or the enemies save well, or they just haven't done very well. But they can usually take a fair hit in return, and that's why I had like the 6 Stalkers to then be able to kill whatever these guys can. So just bear in mind that they're not really, they're not like exploding 6s, everything else, 3 attacks each, they look really strong in a fight. They're not maybe as strong as you think, but maybe that's just how I've rolled some of my dice, but I really do like them for their versatility. And just one more thing, though, that sweet point as well, where like things like Arcan the Black or Nagash or Catacross or a Bone Shaper that can heal those 3 wounds to a unit, they're 3 wounds apiece. So they're not like your Stalkers, which we'll get to in a moment, and the Immortis Guard that can't heal back a model. They can heal wounds to that unit, but they can't actually bring a whole model back. The Kavalos Death Riders, they can. And just bringing like one back is really nice, especially if the enemy hasn't really killed too many of them, and they're still like, I don't know, they killed 3 out of your 10 in your block, and then suddenly you bring one back, and it's like, it shows that they can be pretty well at being endurance during the game. The other thing I want to say, and it's something I've already mentioned, is that if you're taking the Stoic Lord, clearly being able to run in charge is huge, and then using that command ability you have from Stoic Lords to be able to retreat in charge can be absolutely game-changing. Talking to someone who's used that, and then also someone as who's played a bit with Skaven and being able to retreat and charge, has done enough to win me games. So you really are controlling the movement phase really well with, I was going to say Ostrich Bone Reapers as a whole, but mainly in Static Lords with things like your Kavalos Death Riders, and you can use it really well to your advantage and not like catch your enemy by surprise, but there's not going to be loads that the enemy can always do to try and stop you. So that's what I really, really like about it, because a lot of these command beasts and everything else, it's not a case of, oh, they just need to snipe this hero and that hero. It's the unit can do it, as long as that Hecatos is the last one to die, pretty much. And you make sure you're always in range, because like I said with the Mortek Guard, because of how big a block of 10 Death Riders can be, you can't have them all stretched out in a line, because that means that you'll be outside of 6 inches of your Mortek Hector, so you need to kind of curve in a little bit at the edges. But because they move really, really far, like 15 if you want to before they even run on charge, it's not really too much of a problem with that one, I would say. But then moving on to a unit that doesn't see a lot of play, but I really like it, and it's not going to be a battle line. We're actually going to move on to Necropolis Stalkers, which are truly disturbing beings that represent the apex of soulcraft and art. Necropolis Stalkers are nightmarish four-faced duelists that utilize as shock troops by commanders of the Ossiarch Bone Reapers. Armed with a variety of blades that wield in 4 dexterous arms, they are an exception to the implacable style of warfare practiced by the majority of Ossiarch forces. Instead, they move with unnerving raptor-like speed, loosening bone-chilling screeches as they leap into battle. And then looking at the Necropolis Stalkers in-game. So, they are 180 points for 3 of them, and you can take a maximized unit of 6, so only 6 at most, with no regiment discount, and like I've already mentioned, they are not going to be a battle line. So it used to be 200 points, and they came down a little while ago, so that's good at least, as when they were 200 points, they weren't particularly, they were overcosted for that. So then going on to their war scroll, so the description. A unit of Necropolis Stalkers has any number of models, each armed with Spirit Blades. One in every three models can replace their Spirit Blade with a Dread Falchion? Something like that. Just call it the Dread for now. We'll stick to that one. And then they move 6 inches. Bear in mind, everything in this army can move their extra three. So a movement of 9 inches. That's often how I use them. A 4+ save, a bravery 10, and 4 wounds. So a nice amount of wounds there, 4 wounds. But remember, that means that you can't bring back a model with the Bone Shaper or Arcan or Catacross on a Gash. Because like, even if, say, you've got a Bone Shaper and Arcan, so you've combined it together, that's 6 wounds to bring back. You have to do it individually. So you can only heal this unit. So it is something to bear in mind. But 4 wounds does mean that they are tougher on the battlefield. So then going on to their melee weapons, they've got the Dread weapon, we're just going to call it. So 1-inch range, 3 attacks, 4s the hit, freeze the wound, minus 2 rend, 2 damage. And the Spirit Blades, which is a 1-inch range, 5 attacks, freeze and freeze, minus 1 rend, 1 damage. I'm not going to talk too much about that now because we're going to go into the rules and abilities that they have in a moment. That's going to show us that can be a lot better than it says there. What I will say though is the Wound and a Freeze is very welcome because a lot of the time when you take this army, it's looking at things like your battle line, which a lot of people just take the most of, which is the Mortek Guard or the Kavalos Deathriders, which we just looked at. Because they're battle line, you have to take in your army, so a lot of the time you just build those units up. And that's how a lot of people play it. And then that means that it's often looked at as a lot of stuff in the army has that 4 to wound, but really it's just mainly the battle line stuff that does that. So the 3 to wound here, though, is very welcomed. We have got a 4 to hit with the Dread weapon. But what I will say is there are lots of ways in this army to get your pluses to hit or to help your hitting capability. So it's a little bit annoying, but nothing worrying too much, really. And then going on to the abilities, the main ability we have here is going to be the quad arch aspects. So basically, I'll read a little bit of the lore so we understand how it works. So I think it's nice to do that. It says Stalkers are imbued with a powerful skill by whichever of their 4 skulls faces the foe. So you see they have 4 skulls. Basically, they all turn around depending on what speciality from the souls of that skull's personality makes you want to use that skill in that combat phase. So basically, one of the souls was a very defensive fighter, let's just say, so then you can use the defensive aspect. One was a much more offensive, so then you can use the offensive aspect, etc., etc. And you actually have 4 to choose from. So at the start of each combat phase, you must pick one of the following aspects for this unit. The rule of that aspect applies to that unit until the end of that phase. So there's a lot of things in the Ossiarch Bonereapers where mainly comes up in the combat phase, but in more phases than that, but mainly in the combat phase, we'll talk about for now, where it says in the combat phase, you can do this ability. So this is one of the examples here, as with the Shield Wall ability from the Mortek Guard, that you have to say at the start. You do not want to get 1 or 2 activations in and then you've forgotten to say this, which I've done that before. And again, your opponent might let you off, but for me, I want to try and learn the army best I can, so I have to learn from my mistakes. I'm a person who learns from my mistakes, so I have to not let myself off. And it's really annoying when you do, because some of these can be really good. So remember, at the start, one of the things you need to do, get yourself Airwish Reminders, not sponsored by them or anything else, but it's such a good website for you, tells you your whole army list in what order you have to do your abilities, so you won't forget. But anyway, on to the 4 aspects you have. The first one is Blade Strike. So with this aspect, you can reroll hit rolls for attacks made by this unit, which is good because, like we said, hitting on 4s there, that weapon, if you haven't got any pluses to hit, or if the enemy's making you like -2 to hit or something, and you just need to get your hit rolls through, that's the troublesome bit. There you go. Or you've got the Blade Parry aspect, which you can reroll save rolls for attacks that target this unit, which is probably the second most often chosen aspect that I've picked, because suddenly, if the enemy hasn't got rend, you've got a 4-up reroll and save, which meant when I charged in that list like I was talking about, I took to the tournament, when I had my 10 Death Riders, and then I had my unit of 6 Necropolis Stalkers as my big 2 melee damage-dealing units, if I charged, let's say, multi-charged in a combat phase, I charged Death Riders into something else, and then I charged the Stalkers into something else, I would always try and make sure that the Stalkers went into the thing that was less offensive, because then that meant I could activate the Kavalos Deathriders first, let them do their attacks before they get hit. And then the Stalkers, as I know they're going to get hit, at the start of the combat phase, I'd activate their parry aspect, so they'll get that reroll save rolls. And that a lot of the time, yeah, the Necropolis Stalkers still took a hit, but they saved so many attacks that are going to be done against them, so much damage because they were rerolling the save rolls. And this would take an Impetuate Elite, whereas reroll and save rolls are one anyway. It might seem like a waste to spend it on reroll and all fails, but trust me, especially if the enemy's chucking minus one rend at you and you're saving on fives, you're going to need it. So it's a great ability to pick. And then we have the Destroyer aspect. So you can reroll wound rolls for attacks made by this unit. Again, if the enemy's making you minuses to wounds, something like that, very useful. Or wish this was on the War Scroll for like the Death Riders or something, would be great. And then we've got the Precision aspect, which is the most often one I choose because it just sounds great. What you do is you improve the rend and damage characteristic of this unit's melee weapons by one. So the Dread Weapon is now -3, damage 3, and now the Spirit Blades is now -2 rend, damage 2. When you're taking a unit of 6 of these, that's huge. When I was taking them in Petra Elite, my command ability for that sub-legions allows me to give a unit an extra rend. So now, my Necropolis Stalkers, when they didn't have to reroll save rolls, and it was just literally the best part of the game where I could just let loose with a unit of 6 of these, that meant that they were, with the Spirit Blades, 2 damage, but -3 rend, and then with the Dread Weapon, it was -4 rend, 3 damage. Which I can assure you, 95% of things out there will not get a save against -4 rend, unless they're Ishtan Guard or any of those other odd ones you can pick out. And I can tell you, it's especially if you're playing a competitive game, like I'll just get that straight. There's a joy when your opponent goes, what's the rend? And you go, -4, and then they hesitate for a second because they realize they get no save. And then what's the damage? Oh, 3 damage each. How many were there? 4 of them. No, just 12 damage like that. Fantastic. And it's just so reliable. It's not even like, oh, if I get this ability off like that, then I can do it and then do it. No, you just choose the position aspect, so the extra rend, and then you use the command ability from Petro Elite, an extra rend. You don't even have to roll for it. So it's really, really good. I do really, really like it. And it's just so much fun as someone who has wielded it. Now, a unit of 6 of them might go, well, I've only got 1-inch range weapon. Somehow, like, the Dread Blade's massive, it's only 1-inch range. How do you get them all in? Most of the time they're in because they can move really far. And the other thing is that when they were all in there, I had 4 that had the Spirit Blades, which meant that that was 20 attacks at -3 rend when they're all buffed up, 2 damage. And then the Dread Falcons was 6 attacks with the -4 rend at that point, 3 damage. And I also gave them an extra attack from a Liege Kavios most of the time. So really, that turned into 24 attacks with the Spirit Blades, and then it turned into 8 attacks with those Dread Weapons. And people may say the Dread Weapons aren't as good, like you might as well go with the more weapons with the Spirit Blades. However, just the being able to do the -4 against armies that had like a 2-up save, so then they were saving on 6s, as an example, they had even a good 3-up save, no save at all. Did make a big difference in those games. So from my experience, that's what I learned. And the Destroyer aspect is great. So Destroyer or the parry aspect for the reroll saves is the two I'd go for, depending on the situation, the circumstance in the game. Also to say though, it's not like the reroll hit rolls and the reroll wound rolls are useless. I never have used them yet, I will add that. But as soon as the enemy makes me like -2 to hit, I'm using it. Because otherwise, it doesn't matter how good my damage renders, I'm not getting my attack through. And the same with the woundiness. There's a few things out there that can make you minuses to wound that can be quite hard to negate, really, and get around that. But rerolling those wound rolls will sort you out fine. So, yeah, I really do like them. And it's a great ability. So then going on to their command ability, which is really nice as well, Hunt and Kill. So you can use this command ability at the start of your hero phase. Now, this is one of the few things in the army you have to do at the start of the hero phase, which means it was something when I was learning to play with Necropolis Stalkers, I forgot a fair few times, and it was very annoying, trying not to swear, very annoying. So often, well, I'll be honest, in the list that I played, like I said, if any of you guys are interested in the list, I can put it in a comment or something, because I am bringing it up quite a lot. In that list, it was the only thing I had to do at the start of the hero phase. So start of the hero phase, looked at my Stalkers, see if I needed to do this command ability, decided if I needed to. But let's go on to see what the command ability actually does. So, you can do this at the start of your hero phase. If you do so, pick one friendly Necropolis Stalker unit, you can reroll run and charge rolls for that unit until your next hero phase. In addition, until your next hero phase, when that unit makes a move, it can cross terrain features in the same manner as a model that can fly, which I can tell you was incredibly nice, really, really nice. It meant things like, so basically, as an example, let's just say they're moving at 9 inches with the +3 to their move. They can also move over terrain as they can fly. It might not sound like a lot, massively helps them out, because at first when I read it, I was a little bit like, well, you can move over terrain, but you can't move over enemy models and stuff, so you can't really get behind screen. So is it as good, you know, is it as good as flying? No, it's not as good as flying. But, you know, is it that good then? Is it the worst part of flying? No, because what I did a lot of the times, I could be going up against like Stonehorns or something like that, which obviously when they hit you, they're going to really hurt. And what I did is I put these guys behind a big building. So the Stonehorn, as good as their movement is, wasn't enough to get them around the building to charge me. But all I need to do, as soon as it's my turn, I just climb over the building and then charge them. So you can use terrain as really defensive structures, and not in terms of like use it as garrisons or something, but you could literally use massive terrain features, that perfect situation, they're thin and long, and you can just use them as a barrier. So then after the opponent's turn, you then climb over and charge wherever you need to. They're really, really good. And it meant that when I was deploying on the board and I had my Death Riders that obviously have a lot of ball control, but obviously means they take up a lot of space on the board, so they're not the easiest thing to move around. And then you've got Necropolis Stalkers. When I was setting up, I was like, right, we have basically, let's just say on one side of the board, there was less terrain in the middle. One, the other side of the board, there's a fair amount of terrain in the middle. And I just go, Necropolis Stalkers can go where the terrain is. Death Riders can go where it's more open, so it's easier for them. And it was just that quick decision. Whereas if I had 2 units of 10 Death Riders, because these are all the same points, I would have had to go, oh, it's going to be a bit hard for them to move around there, but you know, I can't have anything on one side. So the Necropolis Stalkers just made that decision really easy for me, which was really, really nice, and was lovely, really, because I know a lot of other enemy units couldn't really get around like terrain and stuff, unless of course they can fly. But you can plan around it if you need to, and that really, really helped out. Now, I took them Petra Elite, so it really helped with the rend, but they also excel in things like Static Lords, because in Static Lords, like I've already mentioned, you can run and you can charge in that army. Just flat out run and charging. These guys are rerolling the run and charge rolls, so they're making the most out of that. It's not just they can, normally they can only reroll one of them because you can't run and charge. In that, you can. So you really do get the most out of your mileage with that ability. Again, in that sub-legions, that is a command ability, like I said, lets you retreat and charge. However, you have to have a mount. You have to be a model with mounts. These guys aren't, so they can't retreat and charge, but they will benefit a lot from that running and charging because they can re-roll it. And I know, of course, you're a relentless discipline point, but you build your army right, you can generate a lot of them, and obviously you get them every battle round, so they do replenish quite quickly. And I know I've been talking about Necropolis Stalkers for a long time now, like we're 50-something minutes in here and we've only covered 3 units. Again, this is my long in-depth army series. These army series are the longest in-depth ones about every army for Age of Sigmar that's on YouTube. So that's just something that I do. If you want to have a quick review, you can watch another video or someone else's, it's fine. Sure, it'll be really good. But what I wanted to talk a lot about my experience in Necropolis Stalkers is, from what I've seen, you don't see them much on the table. A lot of people take Mortek Guard because they're better pound for pound. If you want something a bit faster and a bit more wounds, you go Death Riders. And then Necropolis Stalkers don't really see much play. So I kind of made it a little bit like my task to see what I could do with them. And a lot of my opponents were surprised just how much rend I could give them. And it really did give them a bit of a shock. Again, I'll explain everything what they can do and stuff. But they really did pull the weight, apart from 2 times against one person called Luke in the Discord, who I charged his 20 Iron Drakes. And somehow my Necropolis Stalkers didn't really kill them. And then the Iron Drakes just finished them off next turn. Don't even know how that happened. And then when Luke again charged 6 Stalkers with 30 Phoenix Guard. And turns out those Phoenix Guard blitzkrieg through those Stalkers 100%. So, yeah, apart from those couple of times, we were quite funny. You know, like I said, they did really well in all the other games, so they were due some bad luck. I had great fun with them. Fantastic looking models. I also have quite a lot to build and paint as well, so it was good for me because I was like, I only have 40 Mortek Guard or something. I know like you can take 2 blocks of 40 or something, but I just don't really want to buy that many, to be honest. They're very cool, but I'd rather have cooler things like Necropolis Stalkers that I already own. And they worked really well. So it was a pleasant surprise. So if you hear people say Necropolis Stalkers aren't any good, from my experience, they are good. Are they the best thing in the army? No. But you can make good use out of them. They are useful when they do have play. Like I think I've explained enough at this point. So the next unit we're going to look at is the alternative build from the Necropolis Stalkers, which are going to be the Imortis Guard,
who are darkly magnificent in their full heraldry of war. The Imortis Guard are the elite constructs that defend the Ossiarch leadership structure. It is their duty to ensure no mortal vermin sully their master with the business of violence, nor interfere with the sacred and complex tasks of the Mortisans whilst they are at work. With their tall helms and broad shields defending a bulky exoskeleton of layered bone, the Imortis Guard are grim sentinels that feel nothing in the way of pain or doubt. In battle, they interpose themselves between their masters and the most determined of enemy assaults, forming a shield wall and bracing themselves to take the force of charges that would bow aside or break any conventional defence. With their dread halberds braced underfoot, they will impale those who would assault their position, hurling aside these first kills to sweep their hooked polearms through the ranks of those behind them. Now, in game, though, they are going to be an other unit like the Necropolis Stalkers, so they're not a battle line, and they're going to cost you 180 points for three of them, but you can take in a maximized unit of 12. So that is double the maximum size compared to the Necropolis Stalkers. However, there is no like discount for taking 12. You'd only take 12 if you really wanted, I don't know, keep Cash Cross or Nagash alive, but that is a very big investment at those points. So going into their war scroll, so the description: a unit of the Mortis Guard can have any number of models, each armed with a dread halberd and Nagarite battle shield. So they have a 5-inch movement, they have a 3-up save, a 10 bravery and 4 wounds, so pretty chunky, like the Necropolis Stalkers. However, they actually have a 3+ save, which is very nice. And then going into their melee weapons, they have two. The first one, and the most important one, is the dread halberd. So this is a 2-inch range, 2 attacks. Freeze it, freeze the wound, minus 2 red and 2 damage, so that is nice there, I do think, especially with that 2-inch range. And then you've got the Nagarite battle shield, which is a 1-inch range, 2 attacks, force to hit, freeze the wound, no rend, and 1 damage. And then when we go on to the abilities, the first thing we have is the deadly combination. So if the unmodified hit roll for an attack made with a Nagarite battle shield is a 6, that attack inflicts 1 mortal wound on the target, in addition to any normal damage. So that's nice. Bear in mind, you only get 2 attacks with this, but to be honest, it wouldn't really matter if it was the Dread Hellbird or the shield that would do it. If anything, it's the shield that's actually better, surprisingly, which we'll get to in the command ability for the reason for that. But yeah, that's just a nice extra way to do some damage. Try not to forget about it. It's probably the biggest thing to mention there. And then the main ability these guys have got is going to be the Soulbound Protectors, because that is, roll a dice before you allocate a wound or mortal wound to a friendly Ossiarch Bone Reaper hero while it is within 3 inches of any friendly units with this ability. On a 2+, you must allocate that wound or mortal wound to a friendly unit with this ability that is within 3 inches of that Ossiarch Bone Reaper hero instead of allocating it to that Ossiarch Bone Reaper hero. So this is very nice, especially when you've got things like, if you're putting a lot of focus in Arcan the Black, for example, the Mortal Sacrament, he is very nice, very good. I use him a lot of my list. However, he's got a 4-up save and 11 wins, which means he's particularly easy to be killed because he's also a monster, because he's riding that big Dread Abyssal, which means that he's not getting a look at Sir. So he can be shot off the board very easily, or even in combat can die pretty easily as well. If I'm fighting with him in combat and he's going against something that is quite tough, I would always attack with him first, and I try not to get him in combat. But even just against shooting and stuff, I've run a unit 3 Imortis Guard next to him just to try and help him out, and it has worked out quite well. And then also, like, the best example I have, and I know, like, Luke, who I might have mentioned earlier, when I played against him, he attacked me with his Ogre Moor Tribes, you know, Laser Stone Horns, and he put all of his attacks into my Liege Kavios, and my Liege Kavios then went to pass all of its damage onto one Imortis Guard that was left with 1 wound. So that one Imortis Guard and 1 wound took all the damage for this Liege Kavios and made him save the day, which is the best example you'll ever get of the Mortis Guard and what they can do. And I kind of peaked it at that moment, so I'm a bit scared to try them again since, because I know they'll never be as in a good situation to do their ability as they were there. And then going on to the command ability we've got is Crushing Assault. So You can use this command ability in your combat phase after a friendly Imortis Guard unit has fought in that phase for the first time. If you do so, if that unit is within 3 inches of an enemy unit, it can make a piling move and then attack with its Nagarite battle shield for a second time. So a couple things to say here. Obviously, it's a massive shame it's not the Dread Halberd. Like, that's just the obvious thing. You get to attack with the worst weapon, which is significantly worse. I know you've got the chance to do more wounds. But that's where I said, like, the deadly combination, it's good that it's on the battle shield because there's more chance of doing it. But it is a shame. But what I would look into here is if you have got the spare relentless distance points, and let's say this is the last combat phase of the battle round, so you might have a couple left over and you're not going to spend them because you've already done your start of the combat phase spending of discipline points, etc. This could be quite good just to try and get a little bit more movement in as well, because you get that extra 3-inch pile in, which could be good to try and get on the objective or to try and move your guys towards one of your friendly heroes, if that's going to help that extra 3-inch pile in. Because then maybe the enemy is going to get the priority and they're going to shoot your hero or whatever to just try and reposition your guys a bit better for the Immortus Guard unit, as positioning with them is pretty key. And then when we go on to the keywords, we have got Death, Ossiarch Bonereapers, Hecatus, and Immortus Guard. And I should have, if I did mention this with Necropolis Stalkers, the Hecatus keyword is pretty important, as that is what's going to allow this unit to always use command abilities. You've got, so for example, they don't need to be in range to get the 6-up death save of a hero, and they also don't need to be in range of a hero to make the extra like 3-inch move, which is of course the generic command ability you get for your Ossiarch Bonereapers and their allegiance abilities that we've already been through. So the Hector's keyword is very important, and it works very well to make the Immortus Guard, and more importantly the Necropolis Stalkers, as independent units, as the Immortus Guard will probably always be in range of a hero unless things have gone wrong and they haven't done their job. So what are my thoughts on the Immortus Guard? So this is probably one of the least picked units in all of the Ossiarch Bonereapers, purely because I think they're too expensive for their points. They're 180. Now, are they a really bad unit? I don't think so. Like I said, I've taken units of 3 of them. They've done well. But I think the problem you've got is the Ossiarch Bonereapers is so expensive in points anyway. Again, I'm not saying everything is too expensive. Some things clearly are worth their points. But the Immortus Guard just suffer from the point of going, when I'm building my list and I go, so I've got my Immortus Guard, like I've got 200 points left over, let's say. That's really my remit. And with that, I go, right, I could buff up one of my units of Kavalos Deathriders, make it from a 5 to a 10, or even just chucking a unit of 5 of them for flanking and late game movement and sort of like shielding and stuff. Or I could put in some Necropolis Stalkers as a really good sort of like flanking unit. So just a unit of 3 of them, but the enemy's going to can't really ignore them because they can do a lot of damage and they're very independent and can just go up the flank. Or I could bring in a Gothasar Harvester to try and keep a Mortek Guard alive for a bit longer, as an example. Or I could bring in some more Mortek Guard, you know, because for 200 points, you get 70 points left over with that. So I could do that. Or I could get a Mortek Crawler for 200 points instead, or a Liege Cavios or another Mortis and Soulmate, so another wizard. And then it increasingly gets to the point where the Immortus Guard is one of the last options you would pick to spend like your last 200 points on. Because quite simply, there are better things to spend your points on in this book. And the fact that, yeah, but if you take a unit of Mortis Guard to keep you, like, I don't know, your Liege Cavios alive for a bit longer or something, right, you can take like basically another Liege Cavios for 20 more points. So it makes it incredibly hard to justify. I have fought with them and they can do some damage, but because if they're near Liege Cavios, you can easily give them an extra attack. Suddenly that's 3 attacks with their Halberd, freeze and freeze, minus 2 rend, 2 damage. You take them Impetuous Elite. So now they've got a 3-up save, rerolling ones in combat as well. And you can give them the extra rend, so you could make that minus 3 rend. But it just sort of pales in comparison to the damage potential of the Necropolis Stalkers. So my thoughts overall with the Immortus Guard is I don't think they're as bad as people often say they are. But I do completely understand why they are one of the least units picked in the book. I think if you want to take them, you're focusing quite heavy on your heroes, or you want to keep Catacross alive forever, or Nagash alive, I've already mentioned. Or like I said, I think they're quite a good pairing for Arcan the Black, just to keep him alive for that much longer. You could add a potential, if you keep rolling 2-ups of like 12 wounds from a unit of 3 of these onto Arcan the Black. So they do have a place, but they do need to come down in points. Because like I said, the Ossiarch Bonereapers, the problem you have is everything is about 200 points. And the army. So then there's only so many of those things you can fit into your army. And then the Immortus Guard. Also, there's a way to make them battle line. Like, I think then they'll definitely see a lot more play, even if their points didn't come down. But let's say in Mortis Batorians, because there's a lot of named characters from that one, so hero focused. Let's just say that for now. The Immortus Guard then become battle line in that, or the Ivory Host, like I've already mentioned. I think Necropolis Stalkers and the Immortus Guard should be battle line in that. Then I could see them have more play. And it'd just be interesting to see more of them on the table. But I will continue to try and test them out and see what they can do. But I often just find I get to the end of my list building and I just don't have the points to justify putting them into the list. But yeah, that's what I think of the Morghast Guard. But I do also think that they are really cool models. I think they look cooler than the Necropolis Stalkers, in my honest opinion. So I have actually got four sets of Necropolis Stalkers and Immortis Guard. So basically, I can build Necropolis Stalkers and Immortis Guard out of them. Haven't decided yet. And I will build at least one unit as Immortis Guard because they're cool and they have got a place. But it's just quite hard to put them in that place when you're building a list. And then moving on to the unit that started it all, the Morghast. So these guys are all the way from Warhammer Fantasy in the End Times, and they are the first Ossiarch Bone Reapers. And I don't really know if that's in the terms of they're the first ones to ever be made. Maybe, potentially, but then you've got argument of Nagashes or Arcanists, whatever. But the Morghast are the unit that really kicked it all off because the other things are heroes, pretty much. And I actually own like six of these things built and painted, and then I have like another, I don't know, four to build, I think. So I am heavily invested in these guys, and I like them a lot. And the first ones we're going to have a look at are going to be the Morghast Archi. So they are the bodyguards that protect Nagash's champions in battle. They will defend their charge with single-minded ferocity, closing ranks and ignoring the rain of blows that deflects harmlessly from their ebon wart armor, then lashing out to lop heads with their spectral blades in reply. They are silent guardians, save for those instances where they speak in a deathly hiss with the voice of Nagashazar. For those undead warlords that grow accustomed to their presence, they are easy to underestimate, as their mere servitors standing still as statues. They silently observe, learning and remembering every syllable spoken by those nearby and committing to memory the words of any whose agenda crosses that of Nagash himself. At a single mental impulse from the great necromancer, they will turn against their assigned ward at a critical moment, utterly destroying those who attempt to subvert or deny the great necromancer's will. Which, firstly, before we go into rules, I think that's absolutely awesome. You know, so you're a, not even just if you're a liege, Kavalos, because a lot of the Ossiarch Bone Reapers are purely loyal to Nagash. But let's say if you're a vampire lord or something like that, and you've got a Morghast, a couple of Morghast Archi as your bodyguard, essentially, Nagash has gifted you this part of Shaiish. You look after it, you defend it for him, and you expand it for him. And then you've got a couple of bodyguards as well, Morghast Archi. You might go, oh, that's pretty cool. Morghast Archi is my bodyguard, no one's going to touch me. As soon as you say anything behind Nagash's back, you're dead. Straight away. I think that's awesome. So, the Morghast Archi, though, now talking about them on the table, they are 190 points for two. So again, just below that 200 point mark, when I was listing things off for the Immortis Guard, I didn't even mention these guys, but yes, they are like 190 points. They're like practically the same, but they are actually that 10 points more than the Necropolis Stalkers and Immortis Guard. So that is worth noting. They are an other unit, and you can take them in max size units of six, minimum size units of two. There is no discount for taking them as sixes. I have taken them as sixes before, but that was in Legions and the Gash, but they played fairly similarly. And they are good. If you take a unit of six of these guys, they will just blend pretty much anything. However, there was a game where they got so badly debuffed that in a tournament, and this kind of got to the point where I was like, I can't invest too much into one unit. And then that's kind of when I got put off like building Death Stars and stuff, and having only like one and two frets in your army, you really need about three. And that is why I kind of stopped taking the units of six, but I might try again. So like I said, I've got six built and painted. But anyway, on to the rules. So, the description. A unit of Morghast Archi have any number of models. The unit is armed with one of the following weapon options: the Spirit Halberd or the Spirit Swords. And then they've got a 9-inch move, a 4 plus save, bravery 10, and 6 wounds. So going with the melee weapons, we've got the Spirit Hellbird, which is my favourite, because it's a 2-inch range, 3 attacks, freeze to hit, freeze to wound, minus 2 rend, 3 damage. And then you've got the Spirit Swords, which is 1-inch range, 5 attacks, freeze and freeze, minus 1 rend, 2 damage. So why do I really like the Spirit Hellbirds? So because I was taking them units of 6, the extra inch range, because they've got huge bases, really, really did help. And just a spoiler alert, my Morghast Archi, they're built as Archi, but I use them as Harbingers because I think the Harbingers got better rules, and we'll get to that in a moment. So when I said I took like a unit of 6 of Archi, it was Morghast Harbingers, but whatever, they look the same. And when I had the unit of 6 of them, I really needed that extra range. And also, yeah, I get it. Spirit Swords, 5 attacks, 2 damage each. You know, that's good. It might be more reliable to get more damage through Mass Hammer, everything else. You may be absolutely right. However, to me and my reptilian brain, 3 attacks at freeze and freeze, minus 2 rend, 3 damage sounds a hell of a lot cooler to roll. Those are the dice I want to be rolling to get that achievement. I would much rather get to the end of the attacking process and my opponent go, what's the rend? Minus 2. What's the damage? 3. Then go, what's the rend? Minus 1. What's the damage? 2. You know, what a fucking boring time that is. You want to get the minus 2 rend in there and the 3 damage, my honest opinion. And also, you're taking Petrified Elite. Ooh, minus 3 rend. Lovely stuff. Nearly as much rend as Necropolis Stalkers. But yeah, so I do like that. So going into the ability, so they can fly, which is really good. It's really useful to have a flying unit in this army, as you don't really have many at all. And then going on to the abilities, we have Heralds of the Accursed One. So subtract 1 from the bravery characteristic of enemy units while they are within 6 inches of any friendly Morghast. So like we said, we can stack this in many things in the army, but just to give you an example, an easy way to do it, you go Mortis Praetorians, because that makes the enemy minus 1 bravery basically against you. You go take the Bone Tithe Shrieker. So this is the Endless Spell that's like the 4 skulls and the like bloody diamond in the middle of it, like I've already mentioned. And then you take these guys, and that's a very easy minus 3 bravery. If you want to go that way, and there's more ways you can stack it as well. But I don't think like going for bravery is so much of a thing, because at the moment, bravery in Age of Sigmar, there's so many ways to get around the Battle Shock phase that it's not always that important to go for. But what I will say is the Age of Sigmar 3rd edition is going to come out at some point around the corner, and that could shake a lot of the core rules up, including making Battleshock more important like it used to be. And then their next ability is the thing that separates them from the Harbingers, because they get the Ebon Wart Armor. So each time you allocate a mortal wound to this unit, roll a dice on a 5+, that mortal wound is negated. So what the Harbingers get, I'm just going to say it now so we don't have to basically don't talk about it, because I can't really talk about this ability without saying the trade-off and what you're not getting with the Harbingers. The Ebon Wart Armor, firstly, looks coolest, and that's why I built the my Morghast's Archi. But the 5-up Mortal Wound save is useful because there's a hell of a lot more wounds going around in this game at the moment. However, you have that 6-up Mortal Wound save anyway, because these guys are Hecatus, which we'll get to the keywords in a moment. So you don't also get to stack your after-death saves. So your damage prevention saves, basically, you don't get to stack them anymore since Gel's Handbook 2020, which means back in the day, you could kind of argue taking Archi, because you go, well, you've got a 5-up and then a 6-up Mortal Wound save, which is pretty good. But now, you just have to pick one. So obviously, you would pick the 5-up if it was a Mortal Wound going into you, which is obviously a hell of a lot better than the 6-up. But is it that much better to trade off the thing the Harbingers just get, which is basically, when you go to charge, you can charge 18 inches away and you roll 3 dice and add them all together, which is huge. It makes them so reliable, especially if you're taking big units of them to get them all in range to attack. It means you can hopefully fly over enemy screens. It means that when you start doing things like this, a battalion you can take in this army to buff their movement, and then also things like giving the extra 3-inch move, and then going like Static Lords to make them be able to run in charge. You can make them really, really fast. And with that 3d6 movement, it means they're like never fading a 3-inch charge. Bear in mind, you can't reroll charge rolls in this army. So the Harbingers really do feel like they're winning it on their ability over the 5-up Mortal Wound save. But we'll look into the Harbingers as well in a moment, but I just had to say that now. So then going on to the keywords, we've got Death, Morghast, Death Lords, Ossiarch Bonereapers, Hecatus, and then Morghast Archi, which again, that Hecatus keyword is very important there. So then we're going to look at, obviously, their direct comparison. And it's not, like I said, as much of a difference between like the Necropolis Stalkers and the Mortals Guard. These are very similar. They are both Morghast at the end of the day. So it's good they share that in their name because they really just trade out an ability. You used to be locked into a weapon option by which one you wanted to take, but nowadays, for a while, you've been able to choose if you want the halberds or spirit swords, because when I built all of mine as well, if you wanted the halberds, you had to go archives. That was kind of like another reason I went for it, because they just looked so much cooler. And then going on to the Morghast Harbingers. So in the lore, where the duty of the Morghast Archi is to protect, the role of the Harbingers is to destroy. These looming creatures range ahead of the Ossiarch armies, lancing a cold claw of fear into the heart of every mortal that witnesses them. Daunting of stature and aspect, their appearance conveys one message above all others. Here, Nagash rules. All who defy him will be slain and remade as part of his unliving empire. Wielding either spirit halberd or spirit swords in each hand, these winged horrors swoop down onto the enemy before spinning and leaping in a whirlwind of slashing blades, a dire shock to those that consider them to be slow-moving and with low agility. As the heralds of almighty Nagash, they count terror amongst their weapons, taking a grim and silent delight in the screams of those living creatures they were created to destroy. So firstly, they also sound very cool in the lore, which is nice. They're given, you know, the whole like Archi defense and then the Harbingers offense. And you kind of get that, and like I said, the trade-off of the abilities, but, you know, not as much as like Necropolis Stalkers and Imortis Guard. Like I say, they're a lot more similar, as you'll see when we look at their rules. So again, there are 190 points for two of them, taking map size units of six, no discount, not battle line in Ossiarch Bonereapers. So you can see how they're very closely compared, because unfortunately, Ossiarch Bonereapers, so many things are just priced the same points. It makes my job easier because I can compare them to a better state, because I can go directly the same points. They're costing you the same. This is why you should take this unit over this unit. But in terms of variety of how you build your army, it'd be nice if some were pointed a bit differently. Like, it'd be nice if the Morghast Archi were a bit cheaper. So, the Morghast Harbingers, their description. A unit of Morghast Harbingers has any number of models. The unit is armed with one of the following weapon options. Spirit Halberds or Spirit Swords are the same as the Archi. They have a move of 9, save of a 4, 10 bravery and 6 wounds, the same as the Archi. And then their weapons are exactly the same, so I'm not going to read them out again. Ghost Spirit Halberd is a hell of a lot cooler. Don't care about your math hammer. And then going on to the abilities, we've got Herald of the Accursed One, which again was the same, so that's subtract one from the bravery characteristics of enemy units while they are within 6 inches of any friendly Morghast, which is, again, cool. Like I said, you can stack the bravery debuffs, but where it really gets into the differential is, like I said, the Harbingers of Death. So you can attempt to charge with this unit if it is within 18 inches of an enemy unit instead of 12. Roll 3d6 instead of 2d6. We're making a charge roll for this unit. So something I just want to add there as well is sometimes you'll see a lot of things in Age of Sigmar get like plus one to charge from a Hornblower or something. That does not mean they can charge an enemy from 13 inches away. That has to be very clear. Has to be something that's stated here, where it has to mention that you can charge beyond 12 inches. Like it says, you can charge up to 18. And then, like I said, the 3d6 is so useful, incredibly useful, because, like I said, I want to take big units of them, but even if you're not taking big units of them and you just want them to have flanking around the board, so just take a unit of two Morghast Harbingers and just make them on the flank, because they're incredibly fast. You can easily make them movement 12 because you just need to spend a discipline point for them to get the extra 3-inch movement from their Ossiarch Bonereaper generic command ability. If you go Static Lords as an example, you give them an extra average of 3-inch onto it, because, you know, they can run in charge. And then if you also want to go in one of the battalions, they can basically move 6 inches after setup, which is good. But, you know, we'll get into that when we talk about battalions, but it's just something worth mentioning. So you can see just how fast these guys can be. And they're just so reliable in the charge, which means they'll never fail a 3-inch charge. And more importantly, fly over screens. So they can be on the flank, out of reach of the enemy, just about. If the enemy wants to get to them, they're going to have to move too far out of their way. But your Morghast Archi don't need to worry, because they can be a bit out of the enemy's reach, but they have got the movement to get where they need to. and to fly over enemy screens, try and get squishy characters can be useful, a unit or two of them. It might be something I'd try in a near future game, to be honest with you, because I am testing out the Static Lords at the minute. Like I said, I've played a lot of Petra Elite, played that as much to the point where I'm comfortable with my experience of that sub-legions now that I'm going to try out Static Lords, and I think the Morghast Harbingers could be interesting to take a unit or two of them. Like I said, I'm used to taking units of six, so it'll be interesting for me to go minimize size units as well. And yeah, that's pretty much all I want to say for them. They're better than the Archi, in my honest opinion, but the Archi look a hell of a lot cooler. And then going on to keywords, we've got Death, Morghast, Death Lords, Ossiarch Bonereapers, Hecatus, which is again very important, and then Morghast Harbingers. And with that, guys, that is actually going to start to end this video, because we're coming to up to 1 hour and 20 minutes now. I think I've given enough in-depth thoughts from my own personal experience with these units, the Ossiarch Bonereapers. Like I said, these are the core. They're not really the core units, but they're before you get to things like heroes, endless spells, monsters, etc. And some of them are pretty damn big and nasty models as well. And to be honest with you, it's been an absolute joy, because when I talk about a lot of other armies and in depth, of course I do my absolute best to try and give you as much knowledge as I can. But this is an army I personally really enjoy, and it's an army I personally have been playing a lot and I'm working on. So that means that I have that much more experience to tell you guys, hence why the video's probably gone on longer than maybe if I was doing it about, who knows, Stormcast or, I don't know, IDK, let's say. But with that aside, guys, I really hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, please do three things for me. That's smash the like button as if it was the skull of the living. Smash the subscribe button as well, because that makes a huge difference. And also smash that bell notification button. They're literally all next to each other, absolutely free to do so. Fantastic. Best of all, really helps out the channel, and I would really, really appreciate it. What I'd like to say as well is if you think that you know someone else who would enjoy this video, please go ahead and share this video as well. And make sure to leave any comments down below on things like you got a question or anything that you agreed or disagreed with me on with this subject of this video. Let me know down below, as I'll be happy to hear that. And then also, if you would like to support the channel a step further, please click that join button, which is next to the subscribe button, which means that it will allow you to become a member here on Agent Nagash, which simply means give anything from £1 a month and it goes straight towards keeping this channel going. Well, there's also a link to my Patreon down below at the top of the description, which if you click that link, it will take you to my Patreon, where you can give anything from just $1 a month. And literally, that goes straight towards keeping this channel going. If I didn't have any supporters there, you wouldn't be watching this video. I wouldn't be able to do YouTube, as I just wouldn't be able to justify all the effort and time and money I put into it. So on that note, I also want to do a huge, massive shout out again to those lovely, wonderful people who keep this channel going, which again is the YouTube members and the Patreons. With my top supporters, and again, we've just been talking about them, haven't we? And that's going to be my Morghast. So, Johnathan H, Filq, Bleed Red, and Christopher G, a direct message just to you guys. Thank you so much for supporting Agent Nagash on that massive tier. The support you've managed to give me here on this channel has allowed me to keep this up. Really, thank you so much for that, and please continue that really kind, generous support you've given to the channel. And then my vampires are going to be Mia, Martinez, Rouse321, David A, Ronni H, Doug P, SpareBear, Christopher H, and Northdrop. Thank you as well, vampires, because you guys are giving a good support as well, which really is helping towards keeping the channel going. So stay awesome and thank you. And then my necromancers, which is going to be Jacq.l, RadiationRiley, AW77, Dice Sagas, WolfNick, Michal W, Quad, Cranky Wombat, Christopher F, Christopher C, James S, Steve T, Robin S, and James T. Thank you all so much for your continued support. If it wasn't for all of you, no one else would be able to enjoy my content. And because of you guys, I can help get people into Age of Sigmar and continue their Age of Sigmar journey. And especially in videos that take a long time, like these in-depth reviews, it really goes to help justify to me the time and effort I put into it. So thank you so much. So if anyone else would like to become one of these wonderful people, remember you can go click that join button or go to the link to my Patreon, the top description down below. But if you can't do that and you did enjoy the video, like I said, smash the like button, the subscribe button, the bell notification. If you could just do that, it's absolutely free, would mean the world to me. And what I would also say, if you would like to join the conversation, we have actually got a pretty buzzing Discord here, Agent Nagash. There's a link to the Discord in the description as well, so you can click that and you can join Discord. I should say join the Discord more often. To be honest, it's a really lovely place and I need to start giving it more of a shout out, But anyway, I'll let that be up to you guys. And beyond anything else, I'm just really glad that you came and checked out this video today. I hope this helps you with Ossiarch Bonereapers. And with that, I hope you have a good rest of your day. Thank you so much for watching this video. Remember until next time to stay safe, stay hygienic, wear a mask, and for God's sake, wash your hands. So it means when we can actually start gaming again, you can use Ossiarch Bonereapers. And beyond anything else, and most importantly, especially in this video, is remember that until next time, Nagash is all, and all is one in Nagash.